Sigma 16. This is the Sony Sigma 16mm f1.4 E-mount. It's made for Sony mirrorless cameras, quickly becoming my favorite lens, but I have a couple more days with this lens before it goes back. I hate to send it back. Let's do something a lot cooler, like get out of this studio and show you what this lens can really do. Let's take a trip. All right, I'm in Atlanta, Georgia for work, but I have the 16mm Sigma lens on here, easy to vlog with, and hey, look at that. All right, I'm gonna head over to Olympic Park to get some B-roll. Park. I'm looking at the Sigma 16mm lens because it's the widest, fastest prime, E-mount prime you can get at this price class. It's just a really good lens. All right, as we look through the rest of the B-roll here, let me talk more about what I love about this lens. So I just said it's the widest, fastest E-mount prime you can get at this price point, which at the time of this video is $450 US. So right now there are no lenses for the Sony E-mount system that are less than $450 that go out as wide as 16 millimeters and are as fast as f1.4. And quite honestly, if there was, after I've shot with this, I doubt the image would be better for less money. So my primary lens on my A6500 is a Sony 28mm f2, which is a really great lens, but I've tried to vlog on it and it's definitely not wide enough, especially on a crop sensor, which makes the actual focal length 42mm, way too tight of a shot for arm's length. I've been able to do it, but you're going to miss your target in some of the shots, especially on a cam with no flip screen. So this 16mm, even on a crop sensor, is more than enough for vlogging.
We'll see how this looks, but this is what it looks like vlogging. Arm straight out, almost straight out. 16, I don't have to worry about it. I'm pretty much in the shot the whole time, so that's it.
What surprised me was the fact that despite having a wide lens on my camera, I started to enjoy having it on my camera, not just for vlogging, but pretty much everyday shooting. The main reason was that I was finding it was able to capture most everything I wanted, from really wide shots of buildings or landscapes to tighter shots in places where I needed a little more reach. But the reason this works is not just because of the lens, it's because of the clear image zoom feature on some of the newer Sony mirrorless cameras, like my A6500. Having this feature actually turns this lens into a zoom with pretty much no noticeable degradation of the image, giving me multiple focal lengths to choose from, up to 32mm, which again on a crop sensor is 64mm. So I really have a lens that can shoot as wide as 24mm or as tight as 64. And that really makes this a lens that I can take pretty much everywhere. Another nice surprise was the minimum focusing distance. Wow, I can get right on top of my subject and maintain focus. Here you see me working my way up this sign, and I don't really lose focus until I actually touch the sign with the front of my lens, which is crazy for a lens that I don't think is classified as macro. And again, it's all about the f1.4. Shallow depth of field, yeah, great, that's wonderful. But for me, it's all about the low light shooting.
All right, now I'm lit only by a giant Ferris wheel, f1.4. How does this look? Are we staying in focus? Is there enough light? We'll find out.
This lens wide open, it still maintains focus when in continuous autofocus, which is, that's a tricky thing to do, even in low light, and it doesn't lose much, if any, of the sharpness from what I've noticed. It just looks really good. And of course, all this means I can keep my ISO to a minimum, allowing me to get clean images at nighttime. So I'm just not limited to the environment that I'm in.
All right, a little vlogging pretty much in the dark. F1.4, ISO 160, actually it's ISO automatic, but all the way up to 6400, I limited it. So this is what it looks like. It's not on a stabilizer, it's just on a little tripod that is very stiff, so it's probably pretty bouncy.
Also, as I mentioned, it's really sharp, which is just to say that what is in focus looks really clear, and even out to the corners, from what I can see, the image still looks good. It doesn't get blurry. There is some vignetting, but it doesn't really negatively affect the image for me. In the real world, this simply translates into a great looking shot. And of course, there is some distortion because the image is, it's wide. But for me in video, that's just the wide look, and it's not so dramatic that it negatively affects the image. Although I don't think I'm a big fan of how I look personally, my face at 16 millimeters. But again, that's what longer focal lengths are for when it comes to filming the face or people's faces. I don't have a problem with it in a vlogging scenario. And in fact, I even used the clear image zoom to crop in maybe 1 or 1.5 times, and that gives me a little bit less of a distorted view. And I hit on it already, but because it's important, the final most impressive thing about this lens for me was its ability to work with the Sony camera so flawlessly. Even at f1.4, I had almost no issues with the continuous autofocus smoothly maintaining focus on the subject that I was filming. I don't know if Sigma worked with Sony, but whatever they did, it's pretty much a marriage made in heaven. They executed it really well, and I didn't feel like I was using a third-party lens. And finally, this lens, it's not image stabilized, which is something I highly recommend if you're going to handhold your camera while filming. But if you're like me and you have the A6500, it's a non-issue because the sensor is stabilized, which is another reason I love the A6500. Okay, if you're looking for a wide-angle lens, this is the one for Sony mirrorless APS-C systems. Again, this isn't a full-frame lens. It's for APS-C, which is the crop sensor. I love it. I'm ordering it. Leave your questions in the comments, and I will see you next time.